Senator Corker, North Korea claims that they are giving this big concession in giving up the testing program. But how is that a concession, given that their testing appears to be complete because they have advanced enough with their nuclear program?
Dana, look, this is a great public relations effort by Kim Jong Un, and I think people recognize that. I think everyone within the administration and Congress approaches this with skepticism and caution. And yet, I'm glad the two leaders are talking. I'm glad Mike Pompeo is helping prepare the way, as are hopefully other officials. But we'll see what happens. This is a good public relations move. We'll see. We want to see some substance, and I hope it occurs.
So you say it's a public relations move. You don't believe them? Do you not believe that they will denuclearize?
Well, I don't think he said anything about denuclearizing on the front end necessarily. But,
sure. Forgive me. We'll stop testing. We'll stop testing right now.
Yeah, yeah. You know, you can easily reverse that, and all of us know that. And but again, I think he's handling himself well to begin the meetings in a way that almost put the United States on the defensive. But look, we'll see where it goes. I'm glad they're talking, and I hope we have a number of precursor meetings to make sure that the context for all of this is set in the appropriate way.
So you're right, the North Koreans certainly haven't promised to denuclearize on the front end, but they are saying that ultimately they would put that on the table. Is that something that you believe after all of these years, decades, of the North Koreans saying, you know, no way. You think that this time they're telling the truth?
Look, this has been a 25-year saga. And again, we approach it with caution, skepticism. But I'm glad the meetings are taking place, and we'll just have to see what happens. I mean, I think for anyone to try to use conjecture to figure out where this goes at this time is just inappropriate. What we need to do is prepare ourselves, which I'm sure the president's being prepared for this. We have the context set right, and we'll see what happens.
Well, one last question one last question on North Korea. Do you believe or do you think that the U.S. should be prepared to make an agreement that does not include complete denuclearization in North Korea?
No. I don't. You know, again, we'll see where it goes. This is just the front end, Dana, and you know what I mean. We have no idea where this is going to go. And again, I think denuclearization has been our policy for years. This is where the president is, where the administration is, where we all are. But let's see where it goes. Let's don't start negotiating back and saying, oh, we'll let them do X before we even start the meetings.
I want to turn to Russia. You have said that relations with Russia are at their worst since the Cuban Missile Crisis and that there is a, quote, real risk for an armed conflict with Russia. Frankly, hearing you, the chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee, say that is somewhat terrifying. Do you think that the U.S. should be preparing for an armed conflict with Russia?
No, what I'm saying is, look, our relations are at that low point, the lowest since the Cuban Missile Crisis. Our leadership knows that. Secretary Mattis knows that. And therefore, you know, the rhetoric, the kinds of things we're doing to deconflict in Syria are very important because things are hot right now between us. And it's not that we should be preparing, it's that we should be aware that miscalculations could lead us to a very bad place. And I think that's why you see Secretary Mattis saying the things he's saying and urging the caution that he's urging. So if you saw during this last effort, fortunately, when we went into Syria, as we should have recently and did what we did, you saw that there were conversations that had taken place, and Russia had its defensive mechanisms off. They were not operating. And so you know, that was a good thing. But I think what you're seeing our leadership be concerned about where things might go if there's a miscalculation because of the tremendous deterioration of the relationship that's taken place over the course of the last year and a half.
Mr. Chairman, let's talk about something that's going to happen in your committee tomorrow, certainly this week, and that is the nominee for Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo, is unlikely to be approved by your committee. The first time that this is going to happen, likely since about 1925. Does it give you pause to ultimately ram through his nomination on the Senate floor?
Well, I don't think allowing people to vote is called ramming, okay? This is a person that's highly qualified. He was first in his class at West Point, did the Harvard Law Review, was in charge of that. Incredibly qualified person, knows more about what's happening in the world probably than anybody in America because of his post at CIA. Look, Dana, under ordinary times, he would be confirmed overwhelmingly. Secretary Clinton had one negative vote when she came through. John Kerry had no negative votes when they came through committee. He is more qualified probably than either of them, but at least as qualified. And we just live in a very partisan environment. My friends on the Democratic side, and they are my friends, I could try to make them feel bad about this. I could, they've got in their heart of hearts not feel comfortable with what they're doing, but the base, their base abhors this president so much, and vice versa. I mean, it goes both ways. That we're in an era where somebody like this, who's qualified, unfortunately, is likely to be voted out without recommendation or with a negative recommendation. But to allow, that's not ramming through, that's happened before. And to allow senators to vote on this nominee on the floor is the right thing to happen. It's just sad that our nation has devolved politically to this point where someone of his caliber is not going to be confirmed in the committee itself.
You're mentioning politics. You are not running for re-election in Tennessee. The race to replace you in the Senate could determine whether Republicans hold on to the majority. This week, you called the Democratic candidate, Phil Bredesen, quote, a friend, a very good mayor, a good governor, a good business person. Now, we're told that the Senate Majority Leader, Mitch McConnell, told you in a private meeting that those comments could hurt the Republicans, unhelpful in the midterms. Is Mitch McConnell right?
Look, it's hard to believe that the leadership of the Senatorial Committee on the Republican side would even leak that story out to the Washington Post and cause you to ask me about it. Look, I've sent the maximum contribution to the Republican nominee on our side. I've said I'm going to plan to vote for this person. I was in a long meeting where I talked about they were asking me about Governor Bredesen. He is my friend. I'm not going to campaign against him, but I'm supporting our nominee.
Can you tell me why Republican Marsha Blackburn is better to represent your state in Tennessee and take your seat than Phil Bredesen?
Well, I think most people in our state, it is a red state, will focus on the first vote she makes, and that's the vote to elect the majority leader. And I think at the end of the day, that's going to be a big factor in the race. But, you know, Dana, the rest of the story wasn't written during the interview I had with the Christian Science Monitor and some.
Senator, that's not a ringing endorsement of Marsha Blackburn to say that she should be elected just because she's going to vote for Mitch McConnell.
Well, Dana, you know, I'm supporting the nominee. I've worked with the nominee for some time, and I don't know what else to say.
Okay, we'll leave it there. The Senate Foreign Relations Chairman, Bob Corker, thank you so much for joining me today. Appreciate it.
Thank you.